Welcome to Esolang Showcase, a new series where I look at esoteric programming languages. If you're not already aware, an esoteric programming language is, as esolang.org describes it, a computer programming language designed to experiment with weird ideas, to be hard to program in, or as a joke rather than for practical use. Today we'll be looking at Whitespace, a programming language that sees itself a great injustice placed onto the Whitespace characters, namely that they are often ignored because they are invisible. Whitespace is a stack-based imperative esolang created by Edwin Brady, Chris Morris, and Andrew Shribblehill in 2003. The most notable thing about Whitespace is that the only meaningful characters are space, ASCII 32, tab, ASCII 9, and newline, ASCII 10. All other characters are ignored. All of these characters display as nothing in most fonts. This makes Whitespace kind of hard to display. For example, here's a part of Whitespace's official website that shows off part of a program written with it. Yeah, we're gonna need another way to look at this. For this video, I'm going with the following convention: spaces as S, tabs as T, and newlines as N. So the exit from the previous screenshot would actually look like this. Which is still not easy to decipher, but at least we can actually see it now. So let's talk about how to actually read this thing. However, keep in mind that these are just representations of characters that actually appear completely invisible. As previously mentioned, Whitespace is a stack-based imperative language. If you're in a rush and already know what those words mean, you can skip to this timestamp. For everyone else, the first thing you need to understand is the stack. The stack is a data structure, that is, a way to store data on a computer, that is based off a principle of last in, first out. It operates like a physical stack of objects. You can add objects to the top of the stack, called pushing, and you can only take objects from the top, called popping. So, for example, I can create a stack, push the numbers 1, 2, and 3, and then pop 3. But I couldn't pop 1, since it's not at the top. I'd have to pop 2 first, and then pop 1. In other words, I can only operate on the top of the stack, at least directly. This is closely related to something called postfix expressions, which are effectively a compact way to write stack operations. This is what a postfix expression looks like. For most people, this looks like nonsense. However, today, you're gonna stop being most people. Whenever we come across a number in the postfix expression, we push it to the top of the stack. So we see 5, so we push 5, then 2, so we push 2, then 3, so we push 3. Then we see plus. This tells us to pop the top two numbers, so right now that's 2 and 3, add them, and push the result to the stack. In this case, that's 5. Then we see the operator asterisk, which tells us to again pop the top two items, but this time multiply and push it back. So that's 5 times 5, which is 25, so we push 25. Then we see 7, so we push to the top of the stack. And we use subtraction. Now, subtraction, unlike the previously mentioned operators, is not commutative, i.e. the order matters. 25 minus 7 is not the same as 7 minus 25. So we need to decide on the order. Typically, the thing on the top of the stack is considered on the right of the operator, and the thing below it is considered to be on the left. Doing this, we get 25 minus 7, which gives us 13, which is all that's left on the stack. And that's the result from evaluating this postfix expression. In the expressions that we are normally used to, called infix expressions, you'd express this as 5 times 2 plus 3 minus 7. This postfix evaluation process is, in essence, how stack-based programming languages work. You push stuff to the stack, do some stuff to it, and take it off the stack to put it somewhere else. However, stack-based languages typically have a few more things you can do with the stack. For instance, you can duplicate the top item on the stack, which looks like this. You can also drop the top item, which is the same as popping, except we don't do anything with the value. We just get rid of it. There's also swap, which swaps the top two items on the stack. Whitespace also has a copy command, which copies the nth item of the stack to the top of the stack, where n can be any natural number. Whitespace is also imperative. This just means that instructions are done in the order that they are written. Most stack-based languages operate this way, and Whitespace is no exception. Now, onto the specifics of how the language works. Alright, welcome back to those who skipped the previous section. Every Whitespace instruction begins with a prefix telling you what kind of instruction it is. The official documentation calls this an instruction modification parameter, or imp, which is way too fancy of a name for what it actually is. These are basically just categories that exist for organizational purposes. Whitespace has 5 of these imps: space for stack manipulation, tab space for arithmetic, tab tab for heap access, newline for flow control, and finally tab newline for input output. Each of these imps has its own instructions that go after the imp. After the instruction, there's also an optional parameter, which some instructions have and some don't. This parameter can either be a number or a label. A label is just any sequence of spaces and tabs terminated by a newline. Numbers, however, are a little more complex. They start with a sign, space for positive and tab for negative, and then the number's digits are listed in binary, where space is 0 and tab is 1. Finally, a new line is placed at the end of the number. So to write the number 42 in Whitespace, we first write the sign, which is positive, so that's space, and we convert the number to binary, so 42 is 101010. Then we take that number and convert it into spaces and tabs, which gives us tab space, tab space, tab space. We append that to our sign, and then add the final new line, and boom, we just wrote a number in Whitespace. If you thought that was complicated, wait until we get to the actual programming. Now that we know how to write parameters, let's actually look at some instructions. Under the imp stack manipulation, there are 6 instructions which are listed in this table. Here I've placed the imp in red and the instructions in blue. Space space takes a number and pushes it onto the stack, so the instruction space space tab space tab space tab space in line pushes the number 42 onto the stack. Space new line space duplicates the top item on the stack. Space tab space takes a number in and copies the nth item on the stack to the top. So space tab space space tab space in the line copies the second item on the stack to the top. Space new line tab swaps the top 2 items on the stack. Space new line drops the top item on the stack. And finally, space tab new line drops in items below the top item on the stack, an operation which the official documentation refers to as sliding. So for example, space tab new line space tab space new line slides 2 items off the stack. So if the stack looks like this before the slide, it will look like this after the slide. The next imp is tab space for arithmetic. All of these pop 2 numbers into an operation, where the first number popped is on the right of the operator, and the second is on the left. These operations are tab space 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 for addition, tab space space tab for subtraction, tab space space new line for multiplication, tab space for integer division, and tab tab for modulo. Note that the only type of division available is integer division. This is because Whitespace only allows integral numbers. The next imp is tab tab for heap access. Whitespace's heap is just an infinitely long tape of numbers indexed by another number called an address. If the heap looks like this, for example, I can retrieve the item at address 1 and get 5. Or if I index the address 3, I would get 1. Whitespace has 2 instructions under this imp, tab tab space, which stores a value, and tab tab tab, which retrieves a value. Tab tab space, or store, first takes a value from the stack, then an address, and stores the value at the address. So if we pushed 5, then 2, then ran store, it would store the value 2 to the address 5. Tab tab tab, or retrieve, pops an address from the stack, and pushes the value at that address on the heap to the stack. So if we pushed 3 and then ran retrieve, the value at address 3 on the heap would be pushed to the top of the stack. The penultimate imp is newline for flow control. These instructions move around the program in various ways. Newline space space marks a place in the program. It takes a label as an argument. So newline space space tab newline marks the current place with the label tab newline. Newline space newline jumps to a label. So if we run newline space newline tab newline, it will jump to the place previously marked with the label tab newline. Newline tab space also takes a label as a parameter, but it also pops a value. If that value is 0, it jumps to the label. If not, then it doesn't jump. Newline tab tab is similar, except that it only jumps if the value is less than 0. Newline 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 stops executing an insta program. This is required at the end of any program that terminates. Newline space tab calls a label. This is similar to jump, except that when a return newline tab newline instruction is executed, the program returns back to where the label was first called. The final imp is tab newline for input output. The first 2 under this imp are output instructions, and they both pop something from the top of the stack. Tab newline space space outputs a number at the top of the stack as a Unicode code point, and tab newline space tab outputs the top of the stack as a number. The next 2 are input instructions, and it takes some input from the user before continuing the program. This input is stored on a heap, with a heap address pop from the top of the stack. Tab newline tab space reads a character from the standard input and stores it to the heap as a Unicode code point, and tab newline tab tab reads a number and stores it to the heap. And that's it, for instructions, at least. Let's actually write something in this language, finally. Generally, the first thing someone does in a new programming language is write a Hello World program, which simply outputs, well, Hello World. In Whitespace, we need to use a combination of push and output character instructions to achieve this task. Here's what that ends up looking like. Or if we display it the way God intended, it would look like this. Yeah, beautiful, isn't it? Let's go through how this works, just to get an idea of what this language feels like. The first thing we do is push a number, specifically the number 72, aka hex 48, which is a Unicode code point for the letter H. Then we use the output character instruction to output that character we just pushed in the stack. We do this a few more times for different numbers, therefore printing different characters. However, here we use a duplication instruction. This is to save time. Some of the letters in the string hello world are repeats of each other, so we can duplicate some characters ahead of time and output them when we need them. Finally, we run the end instruction to terminate the program. Yeah, that's not as easy as just writing print hello world, is it? Of course, that's not the only program you can write in this language. Whitespace is actually Turing complete, meaning you can write pretty much any program you want in it. Another simple program is cat, named after the unit cat utility, but substantially less functional than it. The cat program simply copies its input to its output. It looks like this in Whitespace. The first instruction here creates a label s, the next instruction pushes 0 to the stack and duplicates it. Then we get user input as a character. This pops a 0 from the stack as an address, and once the user inputs a character, it gets stored to the 0th position in the heap. Then we retrieve a value from the heap, using that 0 we duplicated earlier as an address. Then we have our input on the stack. We then use the output character instruction to output the same character to the user, then the last instruction jumps back to the label redefined on line 1. But that since this program never terminates, it continually just reads input from the user and outputs it, we do not end up needing an end instruction. Here's another program, called a truth machine. A truth machine takes an input, either 0 or 1. If it's 0, then it outputs 0 and exits. If it's 1, then it repeats forever, outputting 1 every iteration. The first thing this Whitespace program does is push 0 to the stack and duplicates it. Then, like before, we get user input and retrieve it from the heap, consuming those two zeros we just created. Then we use a conditional jump instruction. If the value we just get is 0, we jump to here. This simply pushes 0 to the stack, outputs it, and exits. If it's not 0, we end up here. Here we push 1, output it, and then jump back to this label, creating an infinite loop. And there we go, a fully functional truth machine. So, why would you ever use Whitespace? Well, it doesn't have much practical use other than being a thing for programmers like myself to waste their time on when they're bored. But maybe, just maybe, it has another use that we haven't considered, as the official website helpfully points out. Whitespace is a particularly useful language for spies. Imagine you have a top secret program that you don't want anyone to see. What do? Simply print it out and delete the file, ready to type it in on a later day. Nobody will know that your blank piece of paper is actually vital computer code. Alright, silliness aside, as far as I can tell, Whitespace is not used or discussed much even inside Esolang circles, outside of the occasional joke or two. So overall, it wasn't that influential of an Esolang, although I still think it's kind of funny to bring up at times. However, some impressive things have been done in it. For example, Oliver Burgard wrote a Whitespace interpreter in Whitespace, which is pretty impressive. Alright, now it's time to rate this thing. I'm going to be rating every Esolang in the series on these four categories, each from 0 to 4. Notice how none of these categories are just pointless things as usability, or ergonomics, or expressiveness, or anything else you'd usually rate a programming language with. This is because Esolangs are less of a tool and more of a work of art to explore a specific idea or just to create something funny. With that out of the way, let's begin. First up is originality. This is a metric of how original the Esolang is. While Whitespace certainly gets points for only using Whitespace characters, since that hadn't been done before the time it was created, the way the language works is not particularly original. Other stack-based languages are quite similar to Whitespace, and it doesn't really do anything that original with the implementation. Because of that, I can only really give it a 2 out of 4. Next, enjoyment. This represents how fun it is to program in the Esolang. Whitespace doesn't offer much of a challenge to program in. It's a pretty run-of-the-mill stack-based language, only missing things like strings which can easily work around by implementing a basic assembler. It has labels and jumps, calls and returns, everything you'd expect from a low-level stack-based language. As such, it doesn't pose much of a challenge to do anything in Whitespace, besides writing your program in a postfix way. The most enjoyment you'll probably get from Whitespace is, after completing your program, just looking at the absurdity that this empty text file is actually fully functional code. Overall, Whitespace doesn't offer that much enjoyment value, but it's not completely void of it, so I'll give it a 1 out of 4. Impressiveness represents how impressive the implementation and or design of the language is. I bet that any half-decent programmer, given the basic idea of a language that only uses Whitespace, could easily design and implement a language from that idea. The specific design Whitespace goes with isn't particularly hard to come up with, nor to implement, so Whitespace gets a straight 0 out of 4 for impressiveness. Fulfillment is how well the language achieves its set goal. Whitespace's goal is to be a language only using Whitespace, and it does achieve that, but quite a few Whitespace characters are missing. In fact, Unicode defines a whole lot of Whitespace characters, some of which are listed here. Whitespace just raises 3 characters to represent them all, which seems to destroy one injustice and instead cause another. Because of that, I can't give Whitespace a full 4 out of 4, but it will be generous and only deduct 1 point to give it a 3 out of 4. That leaves Whitespace with an overall rating of 1.5 out of 4. That's about it for this video. You can find links to Whitespace's website, its esolangs.org page, and an interpreter I found online in case you actually want to use this language without compiling the interpreter yourself. The script and text project for this video are also available in the description. As always, remember to dislike and unsubscribe. Fuck you. Bye.